Of course, it is inconvenient for most of us to go sailing off to the South Pole, or plod across the Arabian Desert in search of bigger and better pyramids. Flying around the world is fun, but you can't get very close to nature that way. There's always something new under the sea. But what's the use? The folks back home wouldn't believe your fish stories anyway. And after all, why go so far away? There are plenty of wide open spaces, plenty of opportunities for adventure and exploration right here in America. There is, for example, the Monument Valley area of the Southwest, a fantastic wilderness of nature's gigantic sculpture, a rock-ribbed storehouse of secrets of forgotten ages of men, mysterious, forbidding, yet alluring with the challenge of the great unknown. Here is a world apart, yet within motoring distance of all America. Indeed, if your courage and your car can stand the rough going, you may even drive through parts of Monument Valley never before crossed in an automobile. Each summer, a selected group of university students and faculty leaders from widely separated schools unite under the banner of the Rainbow Bridge Monument Valley Expedition to invade this American land of mystery. Books are left behind, but education goes right on. They learn by doing. White collars have been laid on the shelf. Dress-up clothes have been replaced by faded khaki pants, battered hats, and hobnail boots. This is no parlor adventure. These young fellows are on their way to an age-old but still new frontier, one of the least-known areas in the United States, to try out the secrets locked in its rocky wilderness. Here in the land of the taciturn Navajo lies one of nature's own great laboratories. Vast, untold lore is jealously guarded behind jagged skyscraper ramparts battered by the elements through millions of years. From faraway points, members of the expedition converge on a base camp at the edge of the untamed reaches. Old friendships are gaily renewed, yet all are impatient to hit the trail, to enter the field of exacting work and valuable achievement. Wrinkled, sun-scarred John Weatherill, veteran trader, is a goldmine of information on the Monument Valley region. Leaders go into huddle with him to map a series of field trips. Meanwhile, the expedition's traffic department confers with some uncooperative boroughs. They are needed for pack service on a nearby mountain. Looks as if the fellow on the truck doesn't have enough pull with the right boroughs. In case you can't tell, he's trying to get the burrow onto the truck. Burrows can't be used by this party, however. They need boats, for they're going on a 3-week cruise on the San Juan and Colorado rivers. In tiny collapsible craft, they will shoot roaring rapids and penetrate into hidden side canyons seldom seen by white men. Boats and men go to the San Juan by truck. Their route leads through Monument Valley, where towering giants of stone dominate the landscape. Agatla, the mightiest, is nearly as tall as the Empire State Building. Kit Carson, famed Indian scout, gave the monument a second name, El Capitan, when he was chasing the Navajos back in the 1860s. This must be the granddaddy of all the owls. For millions of years, this giant of stone has blinked down on the solemn valley. He surely ought to have the wisdom of the ages. From a perch 600 feet above the surrounding terrain, the owl peers over an outdoor hall of statues of strange colors and stranger shapes. What whim could have prompted nature to create this bizarre stage, set with lifeless monsters? As old as the owl are three solitary sandstone pinnacles. Man, dwarfed by their lonely massiveness, calls them the Three Sisters. Standing erect and aloof is the totem pole, a slender pillar of stone, symbol of the scattered Indian families of the region. For all its slimness, it rises 600 feet skyward, as tall as a 50-story building. On past the monuments they go. Passengers on the truck get a thrill as it zooms over veritable stair steps of stone, reeling and dipping. Hour after hour of this sort of going is a mighty severe test of stamina for the truck. But it doesn't seem to mind. It takes the beating and goes right on. Then it leaps out onto the smooth sand of a stream bed, speeds along gaily. But suddenly, the truck's rear end sinks deep, trapped in the treacherous quicksand of an underground stream. Sand like lead is shoveled from the buried undergear until backs are ready to break. After 2 hours of hard labor, a try is made. Not yet. Back to the digging, boys. Now try again. Ah, that's more Avenue and Quicksand Boulevard call for the sternest stuff in cars and men. But the real test comes on a steep hill that Mother Nature designed with 35-degree grades and corkscrew turns. The roadbed is loose and shaky, and jutting rocks along the trail tear at the fenders. These cars are the first to conquer this hill. Going down calls for safe, certain braking, and the return trip demands plenty of brute power. At last, the level of the San Juan is reached. The explorers are going to face the river's surging currents and rapids in these folding eggshell craft. River explorers travel light, and packing is soon completed. Out into midstream they go, to be carried to new adventures on the muddy San Juan as it everlastingly digs away at the canyon walls. Here's some wild west rough riding, and without a horse, too. Those whirling waters know how to head out the thrill. Uh-oh! It looks as if they're... No, here they come, ready for the worst. Here are some of the promised thrills, and it's no place for faint hearts. The river has its more pleasant moods. Now the men can rest on their oars and muse on the majestic grandeur of the canyon walls towering high above. What's this? Has our fleet been shipwrecked? No, it's just an overnight camp by the river's edge. Boats are turned over to serve as shelters. Without them, the sun might rouse the men so early, they'd have to help get breakfast. By midday, it's 105 in the shade and no shade. Just to keep cool, these fellows go tobogganing. A sandhill is their snowbank, and an air mattress their sled. Guess the air mattress is a useful gadget no explorer should be without. On a siesta a la San Juan, it's just the thing. But then there is a rude awakening and a quick cold shower. Tobogganing and siestas delay the cruise only briefly. The men look like a family of giant beetles as they prepare to launch their boats. Giants one minute, but pygmies the next. From a massive cliff overlooking the river, the party suggests a toy fleet as it emerges from a side canyon under the wider waters of the Colorado.